Hi everyone, welcome to today's video where we're going to take you through some tips and strategies that can help you improve your comparative paragraph writing. We've written a sample paragraph for you today and we have got four features of that paragraph that we want to point out to you so that you can start to use them in your own writing in a way to be more succinct, more analytical and more comparative when you're completing some work for this area of study. So let's jump in. The paragraph begins. The people of Salem and Dungatar both face a constant level of judgment which leads many to live with guilt and shame. The dark and threatening forest stands over the Puritan society and acts as a constant reminder to the lives they are subjected to, one of piety and repression of pleasure. Miller presents the characters as judgmental of one another, as well as fearful of the devil and of the sins they have committed. Abigail is aware that her reputation must be good in the village, and the scrutiny of others is also displayed through jealousies over subjects such as the health of children. This presence of surveillance, both from both fellow citizens and from a god that sees everything, leads to the accusations and hysteria that overcomes the village as figures such as Hathorne and Danforth become God's judgment on earth. In a similar manner, the townspeople of Dungatar project their own feelings of insecurity and jealousy upon others. Beula's searching for dust in Marigold's house can be seen in a similar manner to the clean spareness described in the Crucible. And so it's at this point that we're going to stop and take a look at the first feature of this paragraph that we wanted to point out to you. And you'll notice that we've color-coded the sentences here to look at where they're talking about one text and where they're talking about the other. And the first feature that we want to point out is the balance of each of these texts and how they're brought up in this paragraph. And you might have noticed that it's very crucible heavy. And that's okay in this regard because everything that happens after that moves to comparison of both of the texts. And every time we bring up anything about the dressmaker, it's informed by what has already been said about the crucible. So everything is there to be comparative. In a way, the evidence is put forward about what is being said in the crucible, and then all the comparison comes through the way in which we talk about the dressmaker. Now, this is a way of doing things. This is not the way that you must do it, but it's just a way for you to think about how you are working within both texts. It can be a good exercise for you to do as well with your own writing and start to color code where you're talking about either text and check whether you've actually got a balance between the two of them and whether you're actually getting to comparison. Because even though this is probably a little more favored towards one text, everything that it eventually gets to is all about comparison, and that's what makes it an effective paragraph. Notice as well about how it gets to the sentence here that talks about both of the texts together, talking about Beula's searching for dust in the house being seen in a similar manner to the clean spareness in the crucible is just a sophisticated way of outlining a holistic understanding about what both of the texts are about by being able to talk about them both in the same sentence. Now, as we move on to this next sentence that is here in this paragraph, you'll notice that all of the work that's been done before culminates in this analysis and comparison between the two of them. This highlights the judgmental nature of living within such a close community and the pressure felt by others to present an image of moral and social propriety. Further similarities can be seen through the characters which bear the brunt of such judgment and live lives burdened by guilt as a result of it. John Proctor struggles with his own moral conflict, initially reacting with anger to his wife Elizabeth, who he describes as being mistaken for God, and he feels that in every moment he is judged for lies. However, it is Proctor's eventual realization that it is the magistrate in his heart that judges, and the pressure that he feels comes from within as he works through the guilt of his sins. Tilly Dunnage also carries guilt with her, in her, all the time, due to the events of her past. Such has been the treatment of those around her that she feels that there is evil inside of her. However, without the presence of religion or a mention of a godly figure in the novel, Tilly's guilt differs from Proctor's in that hers springs from a lifetime of being shunned by a society that will never accept her, the judgment of peers taking the place of a higher spiritual figure. And so we're going to stop here to talk about the second feature, and that is the simple language that allows us to be comparative and that allows us to move between either of the texts. You'll notice that there is a section there that's talking about John Proctor and his guilt and using some quotes and some evidence. And then that next sentence here, when we start to talk about the dressmaker, there's no need to reintroduce the text or do anything that's going to be long and laborious. We can jump straight to using the evidence from the dressmaker in the way that we have. Tilly Dunnage also carries guilt with her, because the link between those two sentences is the overarching idea of guilt and how it impacts on characters. This next sentence now begins with that word, however, and that's a fantastic word for you to be getting used to using as much as you can, because it's going to show that you understand how these texts start to differ. And where we've got to with this is not just pointing out that we have two characters that feel guilt, but pointing out that that guilt comes from very different sources, and hence that's the basis for our comparison. And so that's a way you should always be looking to find similarities and differences, so you can always get to that really deep comparison. And you'll notice there the judgment of peers taking the place of a higher spiritual figure. So a really succinct way of pointing out that the people of the Crucible have this guilt that is put upon them by what they believe in and this higher religious figure and so on, whereas the people of Dungatar experience the same level of guilt, but it comes from a different source. Let's move on with the paragraph. What is telling, however, is the manner in which both of these characters allow the reader and audience to see the truth of the situation within their communities, and are both portrayed as having a sense of goodness within them as they acknowledge their faults. Furthermore, those without a sense of self-reflection or accountability, such as Putnam or Pettyman, are shown to lack a true moral compass, as both Miller and Han outline that whilst guilt and scrutiny can be damaging, they are also essential in the living of a moral life. Whilst the sources of pressure and guilt differ between the texts, the impact of constant scrutiny is shown to be a prominent factor in the operation of a fearful society and the conflict of one's conscience. So that's the end of the paragraph for today. And whilst we've only pointed out a couple of features that we think will really be able to help you, there's obviously a lot more going on with this paragraph. It is by no means perfect. I'd love to hear what you think could be done better, or other things that you feel you'd like clarified about how we've gone about writing this paragraph. If you'd like to use it yourself, of course, you can feel free to screenshot it. We've also included it in the video's description. If you've enjoyed today's video, please make sure to leave a comment or to like the video and share it with some of your friends that are also studying these two texts. We have a range of other videos that can help you guys out with your reading and comparing, and also the other two areas of study with VCE English. The easiest way for you to keep on top of all of those things is to subscribe to our channel. If there are any more questions or anything that you'd like to help with, one of our goals is to be down there in the comments and to be answering as many questions as you have. So please make sure to jump down there into the comments and put down what you're thinking or what you'd like answered. Until next time, all the best with your studies.